the last lecture, we were discussing gravity. We found that if a particle is launched from the surface of the earth with a velocity of 11.2 kilometers per second, it will escape the gravitational field of the earth. However, artificial satellites are never launched with this velocity. They are launched with velocities much less than 11.2 kilometers per second, so that they remain in the field of the earth and they orbit the earth and they are bound to the earth. Today, we are starting with the properties of liquids, and the first property that we take is surface tension. You may be knowing that there are two kinds of forces between molecules of a substance. If the molecules are of different kind, then the force of attraction between them is called adhesive force. If the molecules are of the same kind, then the force of attraction between them is called cohesive force. It is the cohesive force which keeps the molecules of liquid, let us say water, bound to one another, so that the whole thing is in equilibrium. You must have seen this phenomenon. There is a beaker containing water and a bottom is slightly wet and it is placed on a plane surface and the beaker is stuck to the plane surface. You need some effort to lift it. And if you are not careful, the beaker can fall and can break. What is responsible for this kind of behavior? Adhesive forces between water and glass, they are responsible for this kind of phenomenon. And you must be careful if something like this happens. You must have seen this also. If you take two glass plates with a very thin layer of water between them and you join them, then they are stuck to each other. In fact, they are stuck so rigidly that you require a lot of force to separate them. What is responsible for this? Again, adhesive forces between the molecules of water and the molecules of glass. They are responsible for this phenomenon. Now, let us see the following. Suppose we have a liquid and this is kept in a glass vessel or some vessel. What happens? You see, inside the liquid, this is a molecule inside the liquid, and you see that it is interacting with all its neighbors. And the net force on this molecule, blue color, is zero, so that this molecule is in equilibrium. And this is true of all other molecules. But when you consider a molecule on the surface, then this molecule experiences forces from below and from the sides, from the molecules on the surface. But from the top, where there is air, this force is much weaker, so that this molecule experiences a force downwards, and that is true of all the molecules on the surface. See here, and if the molecules on the surface feel forces which are acting downwards, net forces which are acting downwards, then this surface becomes curved and it becomes stretched. It is not a plane surface any longer, it becomes stretched surface. And this is because it experiences only weak adhesive forces from air molecules above it. Here is a stretched surface and a force, inward force, acts on this surface normally. And what does this force do? It tends to draw the surface molecules in the bulk of the liquid. You see, there is a net force on these molecules. Therefore, there is an attempt by the molecules to force them inside the liquid. This makes the liquid assume the shape of having the least surface area. You see, I showed you the curved surface, this curved surface. This curved surface is such that it has least surface area. And it makes the surface behave like a stretched elastic membrane. a rubber sheet, for example, which is stretched, so that it becomes difficult to push an object through it. The surface of water, for example, behaves as if there is a membrane on it, and you can place certain things on it, as we shall see, and they would not fall, they would not go through it. The stretched surface stores energy as potential energy, because work has been done by the residual forces in stretching it. You see, since there is a force acting on it, it stretches, and therefore this stretched surface stores energy, because work has been done in stretching it. The surface energy per unit area is expressed as the surface tension of the liquid. You see, take the water surface, for example, it is stretched, and the energy per unit area is represented by surface tension. If we wish to increase the surface area, we will need energy, because increased surface area would require greater energy to store. This implies that external forces must work against internal surface forces to increase the area. There is another way in which the surface tension is defined. Suppose you have a liquid surface and you draw a line on it, then perpendicular to this line, normal to this line, the force per unit area is defined as surface tension, and the units of surface tension are therefore Newton per meter, Newton by meter, because the force is per unit length and it acts along the length of this line which I have drawn. Let us try to understand the concept of surface tension through an example. I have told you that the surface of a liquid is stretched so that little things can be placed on it and they do not go through it. So, you can float a steel pin on the surface of water. To do this, you will have to slightly grease the pin. The pin depresses the surface a little. As I have shown here, the red surface is the depressed surface because of the pin placed on it. And the force, I said, acts along the surface. So, these forces, they act along the depressed surface, and they act all along the length of the pin. And if the length of the pin is L, small l, then on this side there is a force F L, on this side there is a force F L. The total force is therefore acting on the pin is 2 F L, F L in this direction and F L in that direction. And you can take the vertical components, the horizontal components will cancel. The vertical components, F L cos theta plus F L cos theta, they are in the upward direction, and therefore, they can support the mass of the pin or the weight of the pin mg. So, this force 2 F L cos theta acting upwards can support the weight of this pin, and the pin can float on water. Let us take another example. ABCD is a frame with BC as a movable arm. BC is movable, it can move this way or that way. A film is formed on the frame, say a soap film or some such thing. Because of the surface tension force, the film tends to shrink. See, why does it tend to shrink? I have told you that there is the film has surface energy as a potential energy, and the potential energy always tends to become minimum. So, therefore, there is a force to shrink this film. However, if you apply a force from outside, say force F, which is equal to the force which makes it shrink, then the film will stay in equilibrium. And what is this force? This force is S along the length L, S L, and since this film has two surfaces like this, one here, or one above, one below, the two surfaces, therefore, the total force acting is 2 S L. So, if you apply this force 2 S L from outside, then the film will stay in equilibrium, it won't shrink or it won't expand. In fact, you can do this experiment. You can make this frame vertical and then you can support a weight mg which will keep the film in equilibrium. And this weight is mg equal to 2SL. Therefore, the mass of the body that is supported is 2SL by g. Let us take another example. Suppose this film is stretched by a length delta x. That means the area, new area created is delta x times L. So, the film is stretched and the area increases by L delta x. And since there are two surfaces, the area increases by 2L delta x. And if you multiply by the surface tension S, then the work done is 2S delta A. L delta x becomes delta A and the work done is 2S delta A. And the surface energy of the film is increased because I have told you surface tension is the surface energy per unit area. So, if the area increases, the energy will increase. And by how much would the energy increase? It will increase by W, which is the work done. Now, show you a few common phenomena that you can observe. Here, I have shown you a picture where I floated a pin on the surface of water. I told you, you slightly grease the pin, apply a little oil and then try to place it on the surface. I think the better idea would be to place it on a piece of this by paper handkerchief, so that the paper handkerchief will go down and the pin will float on the surface. There are animals, small animals called water striders, which can float on water, which they can walk on water, in fact, as it is said. Here is this water strider. They are actually small water bugs which live on surfaces of ponds, slow moving streams and marshes. They can walk on water. The surface tension of water supports their weight. If you look carefully, you will find that the surface of water, which is called meniscus in a beaker, is curved such that it is concave towards the air above it. You see, if you place liquid in a beaker, then you see that surface is like this. It is concave towards air and convex towards water. And this surface is called meniscus. Why does it happen? It happens because of adhesive forces between the glass and water molecules. They are stronger than the forces between water molecules themselves, so that the molecules of the glass are able to pull the water near the wall of the container, and this makes this surface, which is concave to the air and convex to water. Here I explain this in greater detail. This is a wall and these are molecules near the surface of water, and this is the surface of water shown in a expanded manner. And these molecules, you can see these molecules have surface force S between them, and these molecules, they have slightly larger force, so that there is a net force trying to pull the molecules on the surface towards the glass and upwards. Instead of water, if we take mercury in a beaker, then its surface is convex towards air. You know, remember that the surface of water was concave towards the air. The surface of mercury is convex. Why? Because the forces between molecules of mercury themselves are larger than the forces between molecules of mercury and glass. Here is another phenomenon which you must have seen very often. You fill a glass with water, let us say. When the water reaches the brim, the water, and if you add little more water, it does not overflow. Why? Because surface tension is able to support the slight extra weight of water. What happens is that since the glass is full, the surfaces which were pulling the surface up, the forces of glass molecules, they are now much weaker because the surface, the water has already reached the brim. And now if we add little more water, the surface tension of water will be able to support. In fact, you can keep on adding little water and you will see how much water it can support. But what happens if we add a spoonful of detergent to this glass full of water? The water now starts overflowing. Why? Because the detergent lowers the surface tension of water. In fact, detergents are meant to reduce the surface tension of water so that they can penetrate the soiled portions of clothes we want to wash. If you look at small drops of water, very small drops of water, let us say on a glass plate, they are spherical. Why are they spherical? Because their other forces are neglected, then the surface area must be the least, and sphere is the shape for which the surface area is the smallest. So, these little drops, they assume spherical surface, spherical shape. But if the drop is slightly bigger, then the other forces cannot be neglected. For example, the force of gravity cannot be neglected. And therefore, instead of being spherical, it still tries to keep the surface which has least area, but it is slightly flattened shape that the drop assumes. This also you must have seen many times, in fact. If you take a large drop of water or any other liquid and you break it up into a large number of smaller drops, droplets, what happens? For example, when you spray something on your body, you feel the cooling effect. Why is the cooling effect there? You see, the volume remains constant. This big drop is being broken up into a large number of small drops. So, the volume remains constant. So, you can equate 4 pi by 3 r cubed, r is the radius of the large drop, and n is the number of drops, small drops which are produced. So, it is 4 pi by 3 n r cubed, and from this you can get r. And now, the surface area of the smaller drops is 4 pi n times r squared, and if you substitute the value of r in terms of capital R, you see that the surface area is now n to the power 1 by 3 r squared. That is, if n increases, the surface area increases. So, the when a large drop is broken up into a large number of small drops, the surface area increases, and the energy for this increase comes from the drop itself, and therefore, you feel a cooling effect. You can do the opposite. You can have large number of small drops and coalesce them into a large drop. In this case, the surface energy decreases because the surface area decreases, and therefore, some energy is released, liberated, and it is released. Water has very high surface tension, which prevents it from soaking into pores and soiled areas of clothes. You see, these clothes have soiled areas and water cannot enter because of high surface tension. If you add soap or detergents, then they bring down the surface tension of water and the water can go into these soiled areas and clean. Earlier times, we used to heat water before washing clothes. What does it do? If you heat water, the surface tension comes down, and therefore, it again helps in water going into the soiled areas and cleaning them. Disinfectants, they are also solutions which have low surface tension, so that they can spread on the cell walls of the bacteria and thereby disrupt their function. Similarly, antiseptic solutions which you apply on wounds, etcetera, they have lower surface tension so that they can spread all over the wounds and other affected areas. Waterproofing chemicals are made to have low surface tension so that they can spread and soak easily and effectively into nooks and corners. You see, suppose on a roof you want to do waterproofing, then these chemicals can go into nooks and corners and also into the holes or whatever is there, and prevent water from leaking. They can go into the pores of the concrete also. So, we will continue with the surface tension in our next lecture. In this lecture, we saw that surface tension is there because of molecular forces between the molecules of liquid itself. These are called cohesive forces, and these forces keep the molecules intact and in equilibrium.